وسيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن سيدنا محمدا عبده ورسوله، صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم. أرسله الله بالحق بين يدي الساعة بشيرا ونذيرا، وداعيا إلى الله بإذنه وسراجا منيرا. فمن يطع الله ورسوله فقد رشد واهتدى، ومن يعص الله ورسوله فقد ضل وغوى. ولا يضر إلا نفسه، ولن يضر الله شيئا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته، ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة، وخلق منها زوجها، وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا، يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن أحسن الكلام كلام الله، وأحسن الهدى هدى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وإن كل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. My dear brothers and my dear sisters, the last time that we spoke, the last time that we met, we were speaking about some pondering over and reflecting on some ayat from the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we began by looking and reflecting and pondering over and extracting fawaid, taking benefits from the greatest surah in the Quran, the surah every single believer opens their salah with, which is an integral part of every single salah, Surah Al-Fatiha. And we reached up to the statement of Allah subhanahu, where he says, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. And pondering over the ayat of Allah subhanahu, reflecting and taking time out and thinking and pondering is something which is very important. Something which is of paramount importance in the life of a Muslim, because if we do not have any care and not take any time out to ponder over what messages Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent to us in His Quran, then we should be very worried. And we should take a look and glance at the condition and the hal of our hearts, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ. Is it, do they not reflect and ponder and have tadabbur and tafakkur over this Qur'an? أَمْ عَلَى قُلُوبٍ أَقْفَالُهَا. Or is it the fact that their hearts have been chained up, their hearts have been locked up, their hearts have been sealed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? If we do not ponder over the ayat of the Qur'an, then this is indicative of the fact that our hearts have been sealed off by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Surah Al-Fatiha, He mentions, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. You alone we worship. Ibadah is only for you, O Allah subhanahu. And from you alone we seek help, we seek isti'ana, we seek assistance only from you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then the following ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ. You only we seek assistance from, you only we seek help from, and what do we ask from you, O Allah subhanahu? اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ. Guide us to the path which is straight. The greatest thing any person can ask for, any person can want, is hidayah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If a person does not have hidayah, if a person does not have guidance from Allah Dhul Jalal, then their condition is as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, وَالَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا يَتَمَتَّعُونَ وَيَأْكُلُونَ كَمَا تَأْكُلُ الْأَنْعَامُ وَالنَّارُ مَثْوًى لَهُمْ. Then there is no difference between them and the other animals and other creations that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created. Their example is like that of cattle. They enjoy and they eat, and then they pass away, and their abode will be in the hellfire. If a person does not have hidayah, this is what their example is like. Hidayah. Hidayah toward the sirat al-mustaqim, the path which is straight. And that sirat al-mustaqim, it is this deen of Islam, which one end of that path is here in our lives. Whether we take advantage of it, whether we act upon it, whether we take it, or whether we abandon it, whether we turn our backs toward that hidayah of Islam, one end is here, and the other end, it will lead us toward the gates of Jannah, will lead us toward the gardens of paradise. This is that sirat al-mustaqim. Guide us, ihdina sirat al-mustaqim. And hidayah is of various levels, having guidance. The lowest level of hidayah, which our a'imma mentioned, is that of instinct. The instinct a person has, which even the insects, even the animals, they share in having this hidayah of having instinct. And then above that is the hidayah of having our senses, of having our sight, having our hearing, having our touch. This is a hidayah above the hidayah of instinct. And then above that is the hidayah of having intellect, of having aql. This is what Allah subhanahu has given us, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not give to His other creations. He differentiated us by giving us a mind, by giving us an intellect. But that intellect, that aql, it is mahdood, and it is restricted, and it is constrained. As we've seen many times, people, they agree on one thing, and then afterwards they disagree. They realize that that agreement they came to, it was not the correct decision to arrive upon. Because our intellects, they are limited. And above that aql, above that intellect, is the greatest form of hidayah, which Allah subhanahu has given to mankind, and that is His revelation. The hidayah of wahi, the hidayah of the revelation of Quran, and the revelation of the ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. وَإِنَّ هَذَا الْقُرْآنَ يَهْدِي لِلَّتِي هِيَ أَقْوَمُ. This Quran, this revelation, this scripture by Allah subhanahu, this Quran guides toward that which is the best. يَهْدِي لِلَّتِي هِيَ أَقْوَمُ. This is the greatest of all hidayah, is the Quran and the teachings of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. And even hidayah, we can split it into two types. Hidayah of al-irshad, of ad-dalala, of showing somebody, being shown the path, that is a form of hidayah. For example, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He mentions, وَأَمَّا ثَمُود فَهَدَيْنَاهُمْ. As for the people of Thamud, then we guided them. We made clear to them the path for them to take for success and for prosperity. فَهَدَيْنَاهُمْ فَاسْتَحَبُّ الْعَمَى عَلَى الْهُدَى. And they chose and they gave preference to being blind over guidance. That guidance which was given to them in the form of irshad and of dalala from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not give them any benefit. Because the other type of hidayah is hidayah of tawfiq, of being guided correctly to the straight path by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِنَّكَ لَا تَهْدِي مَنْ أَحْبَبْتَ وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ يَهْدِي مَنْ يَشَاءُ إِلَى صِرَاطٍ مُسْتَقِيمٍ. You are unable to guide whomever you wish, as in the hands of Allah subhanahu, that He gives the correct hidayah to whomever He wants to. So the greatest thing a person can ask for, can demand, and can want is for hidayah. اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ. And that sirat, which is the path of Islam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then clears that path and makes evident for us. What is that path? صِرَاطُ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ. The path of those whom you have given your, you have made mun'am, whom you have selected, those whom you have favored, those who have been favored by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is the hidayah we want. Of those whom have been favored by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So then a question may be asked, who are those who are mun'amun alayhim? Who are those whom Allah subhanahu has guided? Whom Allah subhanahu has favored and given His ni'mah to them? Then the answer is given in Surah An-Nisa, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَالرَّسُولِ فَأُولَٰئِكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ. Whoever obeys Allah and His Messenger, then they will be with those whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made mun'am, whom Allah subhanahu has favored among all of mankind. ومن يطع الله والرسول فأولئك مع الذين أنعم الله عليهم من النبيين والصديقين والشهداء والصالحين وحسن أولئك رفيقا. They are the Anbiya. They are the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Siddiqeen, those who are truthful and those who are adamant and persistent upon that truth, and those who are shuhada, those who are witnesses and those who are martyrs, and the Salihun, those who are righteous. And here we can see that this is the path of the Sahaba of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam. فَأُولَٰئِكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ مِنَ النَّبِيِّينَ, the prophets and the messengers, وَالصِّدِّيقِينَ, سيدنا أبو بكر الصديق رضي الله تعالى عنه, والشهداء, سيدنا عمر بن الخطاب, عثمان بن عفان, علي المرتضى رضي الله تعالى عنهم أجمعين. They were all made as شهداء والصالحين and all of the Sahaba of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam. وَحَسُنَ أُولَٰئِكَ رَفِيقًا, and how an excellent company that is to be among those who are mun'amun alayhim. That is who we are to emulate. That is whom we are to take our teachings from, our guidance from. The Anbiya alayhim salatu wasalam, Siddiqeen, Shuhada, Salihin, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and all the jama'ah of his Sahaba alayhim ridwan. Ihdina sirat al-mustaqim, sirat al-ladhina an'amta alayhim, ghayr al-maghdubi alayhim. And do not give us guidance to that path. Whom those who traverse that path, they are maghdubun alayhim. The anger and the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has befallen them. غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. Neither of those who have gone astray, those who have been misled, those who are maghdubun alayhim, those whom the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon, are those people whom they rejected Sayyidina Isa alayhi salatu wasalam when he came to them. When Sayyidina Isa alayhi salatu wasalam was sent toward Banu Israel, then a portion of them, the Yahud, they rejected and they denied and they belied Sayyidina Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. And as a result, ضُرِبَتْ عَلَيْهِمُ الذِّلَّةِ وَالْمَسْكَنَةِ وَبَاءُوا بِغَضَبٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ. Then humiliation and lowliness was enthrust upon them and they turned back with the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. From his sifat is that Allah Dhul Jalal has anger and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ghadab, and his anger befell those people who they rejected Sayyidina Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. Oh Allah, do not guide us to their path. غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين, neither of those who have been led astray. قل يا أهل الكتاب لا تغلو في دينكم غير الحق. O people of the book, do not commit excesses in your religion other than that is which is the truth. ولا تتبعوا أهواء قوم قد ضلوا من قبل, and do not follow the whims and the wishes of a people who have been misguided from before. وأضلوا كثيرا, and they have misled many. وضلوا عن سواء السبيل, and they themselves have been misled away from the path of Allah سبحانه, أي those نصارى, those Christians whom they made ghulu and they exceeded in their religion. They lifted Sayyidina Isa alayhi salatu wasalam above the makana that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave to him. لا تطروني كما أطرت النصارى ابن مريم. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam commanded, do not lift me up, do not lift me above my status the way that the Christians, they did to Sayyidina Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. Hence why, because of this exaggeration in their deen, they were led astray. And they are those who are الضالون, those who have been misguided and those who have been misled. And when we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for this greatest thing we can ask for, hidayah, to the correct path, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saves us and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguards us from falling into the path of these people who have gone astray, then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam commanded us that when you read this, when you have completed Surah Al-Fatiha, فَقُولُوا آمين, then you must say آمين. آمين أي اللهم استجب. Oh Allah, accept our dua from you. Oh, we have asked from you. Oh Allah, answer our calling upon you. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is the one who answers the calling of those who are distressed. It is Allah subhanahu. Those who are in need, it is Allah subhanahu. أَمَّنْ يُجِيبُ الْمُضْطَرَّ إِذَا دَعَى وَيَكْشِفُ السُّوءَ وَيَجْعَلُكُمْ خُلَفَاءَ الْأَرْضِ أَإِلَهٌ مَعَ اللَّهِ. Whenever we ask from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah Dhul Jalal has guaranteed He will answer to us. وَقَالَ رَبُّكُمُ ادْعُونِي أستجب لكم. And the Lord has commanded, ask from me, beseech from me, beg from me, request from me, and I will answer you, I will respond to you. So say Ameen. And the way that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam commanded us to say Ameen, وَرَفِعَ بِهَا صَوْتًا as in Sunan Tirmidhi. And when he completed Surah Al-Fatiha, he would raise his voice, lift his voice, and he would say Ameen. This is the way of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. رَفَعَ صَوْتًا. He would lift his voice and he would say Ameen. And not only him, all of the rest of the Sahaba of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, as in Sahih Al-Bukhari, Sayyidina Abdullah bin Zubayr radiallahu ta'ala anhuma, when he was that Sahabi who for a period of time he had kingship over the Hijaz, over Makkah, over Medina. He was the Khalifa therein, in the Balad al-Haramain, in the land of the two Haramain. It's reported from Sayyidina Abdullah bin Zubayr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, amman ibn Zubayr wa man wara'a. He said Ameen, and those who behind him said Ameen, hatta inna lil masjid lalajja, until even in the masjid there was an echoing, there was a reverberation from the loudness of the reverberation of saying Ameen, of saying Allahumma stajib Ameen after the dua made in Surah Al-Fatiha. And for saying Ameen there are so many fawaid. Sayyida Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam said that ma حاسدتكم اليهود على شيء ما حاسدتكم على السلام والتأمين. That the Yahud, the Jews, they do not envy you more, as much as they envy you over your saying of salam to one another and over your saying Ameen at the end of Surah Al-Fatiha. In Sahih Bukhari and Sahih Muslim, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam said that when you finish Surah Al-Fatiha, say Ameen, فَإِنَّهُ مَنْ وَافَقَ تَأْمِينُهُ تَأْمِينَ الْمَلَائِكَةِ. Whoever is that their Ameen coincides with the Ameen of the angels, غُفِرَ لَهُ مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ ذَنْبِ. Whatever sins they have performed, whatever misdeeds they have performed and they have put forth, all of that will be forgiven by Allah subhanahu. غُفِرَ لَهُ مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ ذَنْبِهِ. So Surah Al-Fatiha is such an important surah for us to read and for us to ponder over and think over and reflect over its meanings. The meanings of Surah Al-Fatiha are so vast. And in the next khutbah, we'll discuss the beginning portion of another surah and we'll continue next week, inshaAllah. Subhanakallahu aqulu qawli hadha wa astaghfirullah li wa lakum wa li jami'il muslimin min kulli dhanbin fastaghfiruhu innahu huwal ghafur. الحمد لله وكفى وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا المجتبى وآله وصحبه ومن ولا ثم أما بعد. So just quickly as we finish this khutbah, normally whenever we pray individually or perhaps even in a group together, when we are with our friends, when we are with our family, then having recited Surah Al-Fatiha many a time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that وَكَانَ الْإِنسَانُ وَعَجُولًا. Mankind was ever hasty. Mankind is always in a rush. We are always rushing. We are always hasty. And perhaps many of us, after reading Surah Al-Fatiha, automatically, like a robotic mannerism, straight away we go to Surah Al-Ikhlas. Straight away, the first surah which comes to our mind to recite in our prayers is Surah Al-Ikhlas. So let us just ponder a little bit over Surah Al-Ikhlas, how much ever time we have, a couple of minutes, then we'll continue next week, inshallah ta'ala. Surah Al-Ikhlas, the surah of sincerity, the surah of purity, because it contains the purity of our aqeedah, the purity of our creed. And for this surah, there was a sababun nuzul, there was a reason for revelation, a reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed this surah. There was a specific reason for that and a cause for that. And that's what has been mentioned by our a'imma of tafsir and of hadith, that the kuffar of Quraysh, and somebody might mention the Yahud of Medina, they came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam and they asked him that, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, insib lana rabbak. O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you see all these idols that we worship, all these idols that we have, you have brought a new God, na'udhu billah. You have brought something new, a new ideology. So this Lord whom you are telling us to worship, this God whom you are telling us to worship and to forsake all of our statues and all of our idols, all of our aliha, all of our asnam, insib lana rabbak. Then give us the lineage of your Rabb, of your Rabb, of your Lord. What is his lineage? Whom are his forefathers? who is his father and his grandfather and his grandfather. Give us the nasab and the lineage of your Lord. And hence why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed this ayah. To refute their claims and to make clear the aqidah of the belief of a Muslim. In response to their questioning of give us the lineage of your Lord. And this surah, Suratul Ikhlas, has a great position in our religion, has a great position and lofty rank in our deen, because it ta'adilu thuluth al-Qur'an. It equates to one third of the whole of the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And many people, they do not understand how is Suratul Ikhlas one third of the whole Quran. So we'll conclude on this point. How is it one third of the whole Quran? Because Suratul Ikhlas speaks only about one subject, the wahdaniyah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the oneness of Allah subhanahu, the purity of his tawheed, of his monotheism jalla wa ala. And the subjects of the Quran, the main subjects of the Quran are three: the aqidah and the belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how he is one, and all of his rububiyyah, his ubudiyyah, his asma, his sifat. And likewise, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran, he deals with the stories of the prophets of old and their nations and how they rejected them and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala punished them. And the other third of the Quran is regarding the akhirah, the life to come. That is the actual life, Jannah and Jahannam, and what will occur therein. So hence why Surah Al-Ikhlas, exclusively speaking about one topic, about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is in effect speaking about one third of the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One third of the topics of the Quran is dealt in this one whole surah. If anybody recites this surah three times, then they will receive the reward of having recited all of the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the whole Quran, because of the greatness of the topic of Suratul Ikhlas. And bismillah, as I mentioned, we'll begin going into detail regarding reflecting and pondering over the ayat of Suratul Ikhlas in the following khutbah in next week. Bismillah, tabaraka wa ta'ala, hadha ma indi, wallahu ta'ala a'la wa a'lamu bis صواب علم وأتم إن أريد إلا الإصلاح ما استطعت وما توفيقي إلا بالله عليه توكلت وإليه أنيب. اللهم وفقنا لما تحب وترضى. اللهم زيننا بزينة الإيمان وجعلنا هداة مهتدين. اللهم حبب إلينا الإيمان وزينه في قلوبنا وكره إلينا الكفر والفسوق والعصيان وجعلنا مع الراشدين. اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين. اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين وأذل الشرك والمشركين ودمر أعداء الدين. اللهم اغفر لنا ولجميع موتانا وموت المسلمين واشفنا واشف مرضانا ومرضى المسلمين. ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم وتب علينا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين.